Welcome back. We are glad you're still watching The Business Show. Now, in case you're joining us, this show airs every weekdays. That's on Thursdays at 10 p.m. and the repeat is on Saturdays. So feel free to watch any of the days and just learn something about your business. Like I keep saying, this is your show. And the views that we have on this show, the experts that come here, strictly appear here to advise you on how you can improve your business. More importantly, as we draw closer to the end of the year, what are some of the things you're doing unique that should help you stand out? After COVID and all the different challenges that affected businesses through 2020, I keep saying 2020 was more like a mixed bag, yeah? So it's important that we look through on how we can reposition ourselves through November and December and try make some money to end the year. Now, quality products, once well marketed, can win clients, but innovation for every product gives an extra niche. And as most customers will tell you, they'll prefer a solution-oriented product. And that is why on How to Make Money this week, we are revisiting a movable cottage that through innovation is giving a tourism sector a new look. You know what? This particular idea by Amos Wekesa is one that I think if the tourism sector can embrace entirely, we could cut out that space, but also have more people take it up. Just imagine having a cottage that is movable depending on where you want to have it. Let's run you through how to make money this week.
It was important for me as a Ugandan to be one of those people that actually own accommodations in national parks of Uganda. At that time, 2006, there was hardly any Ugandan who owned an accommodation inside the national park in this country. And I thought that's wrong, because at the end of the day, a lot of Ugandans think that everything good must be foreign. You know, the foreigners must own the banks, they must own the telecoms, they must own the construction, they must own. So a lot of us Ugandans have very small dreams. Our dreams are, you know, go to school, get a university degree, get a job after a job, get a piece of land, buy a car, marry, and wait to die. That cannot be a dream for Ugandans. And that dream is what has made this country suffer over years. That dream has made us look bad. That dream has given us a bad image across the world. And yet, God has given us one of the most beautiful countries in the world. He's given us so much resource below our souls. Given us so much resource in our soil and below the surface, a lot of opportunities on the land that so many countries like Dubai would dream to have. And it is us to be able to take advantage of the opportunities that God has given us in terms of our great weather, the amount of water bodies that we have in this country, the amount of tropical rainforest that we're destroying right now. And the only way those things are going to be protected is by us having to have ways in which we can earn from them long term, as opposed to just cutting them down. How do we earn through those things? It's by through tourism. If you look at this country, we've got 10 national parks, 12 game reserves. Those are wildlife-based attractions. But the biggest attractions in this country are not national parks. The biggest attraction in this country is actually weather. We have an average of 28 degrees centigrade average across the year. That's the best weather average in the world. And when you look at tourism worldwide, the number one factor that people consider when they're traveling is actually good weather. Two, us, the people with our culture, the friendliness that we don't take advantage of as Ugandans, is much bigger than the national parks. Our water bodies, there's no country in Africa that has got as many rivers and freshwater lakes than Uganda has. Now, that's just an attraction that we've not taken advantage of. Anyway, let's go back to business. 10 national parks, 12 game reserves. We have less than 1,500 rooms in all of them combined. If you go to Kenya, Masai Mara, which is maybe 2,500 square kilometers alone, probably by the end of next year, we'll have 5,000 rooms. Now, one national park in Kenya will have three, four times the amount of rooms that this whole country has got. What does that mean? It means that we have not done enough to build, but at the same time, it gives us an opportunity as Ugandans to think about investing. We should be waking up and invest in these national parks. Now, it is very difficult to try and raise capital in this country. I was blessed that I started out as a sweeper, became an office messenger, became a tour guide, and became what I am able to do today. But it's taken me 26 years of hard work. Now, to build that capital has taken me all these years. Now, an average guy may not necessarily have all that time to be able to build or have those 25 years on them to be able to build those, whatever I've been able to do. However, we have a country that has people with a bit of money here and there, but cannot put up one full entity. People like myself as entrepreneurs, not just in tourism, must, because quite a number of guys are watching, and those who are entrepreneurs, entrepreneurship should not be a selfish approach. It should be an approach like this where you create an environment where everybody can come and be able to showcase their opportunities. Now, as Amos, I still believe that the best way to grow is to grow with others. So when we had a discussion, I said, okay, I have already locations across the country. Some already built, some aren't built. So we're going to start building those that aren't. I could, over time, build the things myself. But if I get more Ugandans buying into having a container, for example, the first 10 containers are going to go to Simba Safari Camp. Simba Safari Camp is already established. It has a restaurant, has management, it has swimming pools, has other rooms. Now, if a person buys one container, they'll have a code to their room, and they are allowed to sell that container once a year, 1 month in a year. So you can come, either stay there with your family or just enjoy. The rest of the time, you'll be able to sell it to clients. So we'll be saying that we're getting clients and they may pay $150. That will include the construction. I mean, it will include the maintenance, cleaning, the restaurant running, the cost of electricity and everything else. The owner will probably carry home about $50 a night it's occupied. Now you do the mathematics and say, all right, I will probably invest, I'll probably work 100 days in a year out of 165 days, whatever it is. That alone, if you multiply $550 times 100 days in a year, what is that? $5,000, the at minimum that you'll be able to get. Now, if I am a parent and I'm having a kid that will need $5,000 for school fees, or two kids that will need $5,000 for school fees, I will have invested in a container. At the same time, I'll be able to raise school fees for my children for that period of time. Now, for the amount of money you invest, our ask will be very clear. We will ask you to make sure that every time we have clients, you're able to pass the code to us, such that clients occupy it. One, it gives us security. Me as an investor, as an entrepreneur, gives me a chance to know that actually somebody, it gives me a chance to have someone have a second eye for myself. So the owner will have interest in making sure that he knows that the room has been occupied. Number two, I'll also know that someone's giving me an extra eye. But if I have you, I have 10 more people who are helping me in marketing this concept, it actually improves our operations as a business. And that's what we're all discussing this morning. If you don't dream, your children will have no dreams. Your grandchildren will have no dreams. So people like myself, sometimes you work hard, not because you want to eat. I stopped thinking about my basics becoming hard for me a long time ago after I worked hard. Right now, the thing is, I work hard because I just want to be a good example if I can. And I've reached a stage of takeoff right now in terms of business. And this stage gives me a chance to be able to, you know, encourage people to do things we're talking about this morning. We got to dream. We have to aspire for bigger things. Now, it also takes two types of people. One, it takes the investor who thinks long term, because one of the challenges for Uganda, one of the reasons why we don't grow, is that a lot of people think that I need to invest $100 and I need to make $100 the same day. That's not how life works. You know, yesterday I was writing on my Facebook page that Bolt says, I trained for 4 years to run for 9 seconds. Some people will do something for 2 months, and if they don't see returns in those 2 months, we take off. That's how we think. And that's actually, it describes who we are as a people, generally speaking. So the investor might think long term. I mean, the investor might think long term. Then you need an entrepreneur. So an entrepreneur is a guy who puts the whole concept together. For example, with these cottages, they're going to be put at Simba Safari Camp. The marketing is going to be my responsibility. The running of the place is going to be my responsibility. Why? I have history. I have proof. 12 containers are being produced, like Prosper has ably talked about. So you'll be able to talk about, it's good for the environment. Number two, they're quicker to put together, especially after you're finished with the prototype like we have. It's quicker. Number three, if you want to turn the site into something else, it's much easier to shift your container to another place. So there are factors like that that are very important, because the tourism industry, specifically in adventure environment like national parks, things change very fast. And sustainability is such an important element. Prosper has been to some of my lodges. If you look at Simba Safari Camp and Elephant Plains in Queen Elizabeth National Park, the time I took over that place, those were cotton gardens. There was no single tree on the hill. And right now it's a forest. Actually, when you pass on the road to Beira, you may not recognize that there's Simba Safari Camp next door. But it was only, it was cotton. If you go to Primate Lodge, where we built all the rooms, it was grassland. If you go there right now, 100 meters, you won't see, it's just tropical rainforest in the last 16, 14 years. So, and that's what attracts people. And those trees act as habitats for birds, for primates, for big mammals, like the elephant, forest elephants, buffaloes. These are very important attractions for the country. Now, like I said, if anything comes up and you want to transform the place into anything else, it's easier to get up, carry a container, take it to another place. If your interests are done in a particular area and say, I am done with Queen Elizabeth National Park and I need to invest, say, in Jinja, it's much easier for you to go to Jinja, buy a piece of land on the Nile and be able to invest. And I tell you guys, young people, listen, listen. 16 years ago, I went on the Nile and I was buying land at $200 an acre in Jinja. And I remember telling friends of mine, and I said, in Egypt, if your great-great-grandfather never bought land on the Nile, you cannot afford to live probably even a kilometer away from the Nile. We have the Nile here. We're all in Kampala having fun. But you go to Jinja now. For 30 kilometers, it's actually called Muzungulen. I think out of 10 or 12 Ugandans who are on the waterfront, I took 8 of the Ugandans. And it took me so much to convince them that it's okay. The Nile is such an important element. When you go to Europe or US, I do a lot of marketing myself. And you convince people that actually the Nile starts in Uganda. People think you're so patriotic that you can lie for your own country. That's how bad it is. Now, you guys, the English took 200 years just to looking for the source of the Nile. That's what happened. So think as a people along the Nile, buy anything that you can get your hands on, all the way to Nimule. And the farther you go, the better, because it'll be cheaper. 16 years ago when I bought that land, not many guys were interested in it. Today, even if you came with $50,000 each acre, I can't give it to you. Like, almost every part of this country has an attraction. It either has a river, a lake, a mountain, rocks, you know, good weather, good culture, good food. Every bit of Uganda is so blessed, and I think that's why we will be poor. We will never prosper, because just God just over blessed us, you know. That's a big for you to, and let's take it serious. Uganda has 48.9% of East Africa's arable land. You get Kenya, Tanzania, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi put together, we have 48.9% of the fertile land. 85% of our land is fertile. And even the 15%, you can scratch and still get something. Kenya has less than 30%, but they export 100 times more than Uganda does, that has a beautiful land. It's us, because we don't understand the blessing that we have. So that said, that there's going to be a lot of opportunities in investment. Uganda right now, if we do the marketing, and even if we don't do the marketing, Uganda's numbers are going up. Our numbers at the airport, even without marketing, have moved 10 years ago from less than 1 million people, 800,000 people, to about 1.8 million. But even 1.8 million is only equivalent to Moi International Airport in Kenya, which is in Mombasa. We're not there yet. But as the numbers increase, the demand for the rooms also increase. We also can see a number of international chains of hotels are increasing. I sit on the International Investment Hotel Forum, which brings together in Africa, which brings together all the big chain hotels. Now, before I went to start advocating for investors like Hilton, Marriott to come to Uganda, Uganda had only one five-star hotel of international level, and that is Sheraton. Kenya, 4 years ago, had 68 international chains of hotels with more than one hotel in the Kenya. And by end of next year, Kenya will have 88 international chains of hotels. Now, if you want to know a country that's doing business and it's prospering worldwide, number one is look at the airport. How many international people go through the airport? If you have very few people going through the airport, you're just a poor group of people. Number two, if you have no international chains of hotels, you are a group of poor people. So you can speak as much English as you want, but you are poor. So those are the facts.
So amazing stuff there from the tourism sector and technology and innovation. Almost everyone will tell you will be the next drivers for economic growth. But the debate has been, should we simply say technology will help us, or on top of technology, there are some principles that must be followed keenly. For instance, branding, quality of the products, packaging, and then by the time we say we're now moving out to market these products, we are able to meet all the others. Because what kind of product are you putting out on social media? Are you going to take some photos and just post stuff because, well, technology is here? Or when you talk about innovation, are you innovating something that is needed on the market, or it's an imagination? And for years as a business person, you're saying, well, I think this is good for me. Always remember, the customer is the king. So whatever you're trying to develop should be able to answer the needs in the market or society. Okay, let's talk personal finance tips for this week. And in our month-long segment, we are now talking why financial literacy is important. And today we are speaking to Oscar Mwanga, who is the principal rates and credit training boss at Standard Chartered Bank, and he's telling us how it is possible to actually start on the journey of financial literacy. This is Personal Finance.
Okay, so welcome to this segment, Oscar, where we talk about investment and you're here to share knowledge with us. Thank you so much. But before we begin, kindly introduce yourself.
Thanks, Cynthia. My name is Oscar Mwanga and I look after the fixed income department for Standard Chartered Bank.
Tell us about financial literacy, investment, and why that is important. And where do we start if we want to, you know, be financially free? Where do we start?
Absolutely, and I think I like the last part of your question. Where do we start? And I believe the genesis should be understanding what are financial instruments, how do they work, what are their characteristics, mm-hmm. you know, when do you use them? And financial literacy is quite broad, and like any subject, it's one that requires an understanding of what are my options, where can, you know, my financial literacy take me. As an example, you will know how to budget, it covers how to save, it covers insurance, it covers investments, it covers fraud and how to avoid such incidences. We've seen in the press recently, BLQ was made the news quite a bit recently for the wrong reasons. It turned out to be a Ponzi scheme. With financial literacy, you might not even get to hear about these Ponzi schemes, because in terms of your knowledge and understanding, you'll be able to investigate this product. How does it work? How does it generate returns? You know, who are the shareholders? How do I find more information about it? and to also compare different investments. So financial literacy is the backbone of financial freedom, I would say, because you know it gives you a guide, you know, of the available options and a map to follow to get to that destination that you would like to go to.
You know, Oscar, I don't know why in our education system, from the time we were six, people are not teaching us about managing money and being financially literate.
Yeah.
So you were talking about all the things, saving, it's like broad, but we are dying of poverty. Everybody's crying, economy, economy. And in there you have young people, old people, right?
Yeah.
So, and we are talking investment, financial literacy means you should have been planning all along.
Yeah.
So where does someone start to really liberate themselves? I've heard of interesting stories, like for instance, guys who started investing at 80 and they became rich, like KFC stories, right? So where do I start and when should I start? Is it too late when I'm old?
It's never too late. But there is a good time to start, and I believe most of our viewers are between 18 and 28 years old. That is the best time to start, because at 18 you have a part-time job, for example. Those ages are the prime ages to start off. Here's why. The biggest benefit that anybody has on their investment journey is time. So the amount of money is not the most important thing. To invest in a government bond, for example, costs or starts at 100,000 shillings. Which is, I would say, a manageable amount of money. But you wouldn't believe, a person who starts investing at 18, 1 shilling, and a person who starts investing at 28, the same 1 shilling, into 65 years old, the person who started at 18 will have grown that shilling by 88 times, as an example. The person who started at 28 would have grown it by 38 times. So the difference is 10 years, but over the long haul, it's quite a significant difference in terms of outcomes. So, which is why it's key to start as soon as you can and with whatever you have. And I think the genesis of all of that is saving, living within your means. So if you earn 10 shillings, live on half. You know, save a portion of it, because the number is relative, but the difference is night and day. Cynthia, if you save 10 shillings and you earn 100 shillings and I earn 100,000 and save nothing, you're much better off than I am, strictly speaking. So that's why I said the amount is not important, but starting the habit, especially when you have little to begin with, and growing that habit as you earn more, which is a sure thing for most people.
So that's interesting. And do you know you can borrow and start investing, right?
You can.
Is that a good thing to do?
It really depends, because, you know,
if you don't have, I mean, listen, if you're so broke right now, everybody has nothing, you live hand to mouth,
yeah,
where will I get money to invest?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, most businesses could start off by either saved capital. You could, right now we have peer funding. You could get capital from your parents or your friends. And it also depends on the cost of that capital. If you borrow, let's say, at commercial rates to invest, if on the other hand you borrowed using equity, meaning that, Cynthia, I come to you as a friend, you lend me money, and my group of friends lends me money, that could be considered long-term money, where somebody has an equity stake in your company. While that doesn't have the pressure of a commercial loan, for example, you've then given up some shareholding of your company. So I think it's relative. But I think it's crucial here to understand, you know, what you're going to generate versus, you know, what is costing you to generate that money. So I think it's important to, you know, to realize that money at 18% or 15%, whatever the rate may be, it should be below what you're going to earn from that money. And I, you know, on borrowing to invest, I think that is a very good way to think about it. What's more common is borrowing to consume.
Yeah.
That is quite dangerous. Because you know the debt has a cost. When you consume, that evaporates immediately. So it's important to, if you're borrowing, which is a liability, you're investing in an asset which brings in income. So I think that is really crucial.
So personal finance is probably one of those segments I love the most, because whereas most of us can have money, some of us are saving money, but if you actually ask a guy, why are you saving money? They simply say, I am saving because I have a lot of it. Have you ever imagined that if you save money without any goal, the value of that money depreciates over time? So before you actually sit down to start saving money, draw a plan and say, I will save for the next 6 months, and this is what I want to attain after 6 months. Other than that, you just save money for all the years, and when you walk back and look at how much you've saved, it's a lot, but the actual value of that money has depreciated. Let's run you through the money markets, and the markets were fairly liquid according to ABSA, with yields at averages of about 11.35%. Here now is the comprehensive report of the money markets. If you look through the fuel pumps across, about 5,800 or 5,888, that is for Shell and Total. Of course, those are more like the market pace setters. Then the other guys will go slightly below that. But what's interesting is that fuel prices, though they are continuing to drop, they are still responsible for the increase in inflation. Now, that's according to a report by UBOS that was issued on Monday. Let's see how the major cities across the country are faring in terms of fuel prices. I really have to go now, but just before I leave you, listen, a brand for a company is like a reputation for a person. You can earn reputation by trying to do hard things well. I guess someone is saying, just say that again. Listen, a brand for a company is like a reputation for a person. You can earn reputation by trying to do hard things well. That is according to Jeff Bezos. And for me, and the rest of the team here, is we'll see you next week. Take care of yourselves, keep making money, and don't forget to join us on Tuesday as we bring you the latest in the business clinic, tips on how you can support your business. Also, feel free to get in touch, and until then, we'll see you soon. Bye for now.